Once again, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Indy Neidell, and this is Out of the Trenches, where I sit here in the chair of wisdom and answer all your questions about the First World War. Justin asks, during the war so far, the German army has suffered almost as many or significantly less casualties compared to the Allied forces, even when attacking. At the Battle of Passchendaele, the German army suffered about 359,000 and the Allies about 226,000 killed, wounded, or missing in action. What do you think was the cause that made the Germans have so many more casualties when they've usually been around the same as the French and British? P.S. Love the show. Thank you. You know, for once, I can't really answer your question at all for the following and rather simple reason. The accurate number of casualties during the whole of the Battle of Passchendaele is pretty strongly disputed among historians to this day. The reports vary between a low count of 200,000 and a high count of 400,000 of German soldiers killed, wounded, or missing. In the months and the years directly after the war, British officials had no or limited access to German records, and a lot of numbers were just estimated. In the 50s and 60s, new historians began to question the official reports, and many accused them of being extremely inaccurate or even just fabricated. Often it seems they simply added around 30% more German casualties if they didn't know for sure. It seems like the only more or less reliable information on this particular subject that survived the wars is the German Sanitätsbericht, which lists the official number of German casualties as high as 217,194. But the Germans often counted casualties differently from the British, dismissing a lot of the lightly wounded or the sick in their reports, which ended up not being counted. So it comes down to, basically, whichever historian you want to believe has the right answer. Damien Weissenant writes, I have a question that I should probably know the answer to, but don't. I own an old World War I bayonet, and it seems to be pretty much a short sword. Were any used as such? You hear about soldiers using makeshift clubs and knives, but that seems redundant if most soldiers had essentially a short sword with them. Well, true, most bayonets of the Great War were classified as sword bayonets since their shape was fairly similar to a medieval short sword. Oh, except for the needle-like spike bayonets, of course. Before a regular attack, officers would usually call upon the soldiers to uniformly fix their bayonets on their rifles. So the bayonet was stuck on the rifle, turning it into a potential glaive or spear. The basic idea of using the bayonet in trench warfare was in the initial rush, soldiers would either, you know, jump upon the enemy and drive it like a spear into the body, or to finish off an enemy who'd been knocked off his feet by something else. Inside the trenches themselves, there was little use for the bayonet most of the time, though. Even if a soldier took it off his rifle, it was still too unwieldy in close quarters. Trench raiders, on the other hand, did not conform to those regularities. Many soldiers of those kill teams wouldn't even carry a rifle at all, but would have clubs, knuckle dusters, and knives. It wasn't about precision or grace or strength or technique. It was about killing or stunning your enemy as quickly and efficiently as possible in very tight spaces. In All Quiet on the Western Front, which is fictional, but of course is based on Remarque's war experiences, he says they stopped using the bayonets because they would get stuck in the chest cavity, and it would take too long to pull them out, and you'd be vulnerable while you were trying to get your bayonet out. So, yeah, heavy stuff. Academic 1740 writes, Hi, Indian crew. I'm a bigger fan of your show than Cadorna was of planning battles on the Isonzo. That's a big fan. Wow. Okay. And I wanted to submit this as an out of the trenches question. Okay. This week, Jerusalem was surrendered to the Egyptian Expeditionary Force. So I guess you wrote this a little while ago. Okay. Some might see this as the first point in many hundreds of years since the times of the Crusader States that Westerners were in control of the city. Did this stir up any negative feelings or cause any problems amongst any Muslims who were fighting for the British Empire, such as members of the Arab Revolt or any colonial troops, given the possible connotations? or were those fighting with the British generally happy to see the city out of Ottoman hands? Thanks. Okay, well, Allenby, General Edmund Allenby, he certainly tried his hardest to not appear like a crusader and entered the city without unnecessary pomp. So he walked in instead of entering on horseback, which his standing as a British general would have certainly allowed. London had sent him a list beforehand naming all the things Allenby had to avoid during his speech in front of the holy site of three global religions. And it was actually rather well received by the religious authorities. Nevertheless, many newspapers of the Western world used and reinforced the crusader conqueror image in their reportings. The New York Herald, for example, wrote headlines like, "Jerusalem captured from the Muslims, Christianity rejoices," things like that. But for the moment, Muslims supported the capture of Mecca by the Arabs and Jerusalem by the British, since it would deny the Ottoman Empire the sovereignty over all those holy sites. During the occupation of Jerusalem, there were a few smaller incidents that did stir up religious troubles. Like once, some British soldiers thought the green flag of Islam was like the red Turkish flag, a symbol of allegiance with the Ottomans, so they tore them down. Right? Others were so filled by the Jerusalem syndrome, as it was called, that they walked into private homes and holy sites in their desire to follow the trail of the Bible. And because of things like that, there were groups of Muslim zealots that demonstrated against the infidel ruler of the city. Allenby reacted by relying on his Indian soldiers, many of them Muslims themselves. They would guard the holy sites of the Muslims and help reinforce the image of a peaceful, multi-religious force instead of purely Christian conquerors. The actual religious problems would start in earnest after the war was over and the Muslim population became aware of the consequences of the Sykes-Picot Agreement and the British support of Zionism. That's when many Islamic groups and organizations worldwide got involved. As always, we encourage you to do further research on your own if you are interested in the subject. Just be aware that there is a lot of misinformation and many wrongly attributed quotes swimming around on the internet, so always check your sources twice. And speaking of crusaders and the Middle Ages, if you'd like to hear our podcast episode with John Ridge, where we talked about medievalism during the First World War, you can find a link to that in the description below. And do not forget to follow us on Twitter and like us on Facebook too. See you next time.